Chapter 16. Memory. In the last chapter zero, what concerned us was the direct intuition of time. We found it limited to intervals of considerably less than a minute. Beyond its borders extends the immense region of conceived time, past and future, into one direction or another of which we mentally project all the events which we think of as real, and form a systematic order of them by giving to each a date. The relation of conceived to intuited time is just like that of the fictitious space pictured on the flat back scene of a theater to the actual space of the stage. The objects painted on the former, trees, columns, houses in a receding street, etc., carry back the series of similar objects solidly placed upon the latter, and we think we see things in a continuous perspective, when we really see thus only a few of them and imagine that we see the rest. The chapter zero which lies before us deals with the way in which we paint the remote past, as it were, upon a canvas in our memory, and yet often imagine that we have direct vision of its depths. The stream of thought flows on, but most of its segments fall into the bottomless abyss of oblivion. Of some, no memory survives the instant of their passage. Of others, it is confined to a few moments, hours, or days. Others, again, leave vestiges which are indestructible, and by means of which they may be recalled as long as life endures. Can we explain these differences? Primary memory. The first point to be noticed is that for a state of mind to survive in memory it must have endured, for a certain length of time. In other words, it must be what I call a substantive state. Prepositional and conjunctival states of mind are not remembered as independent facts. We cannot recall just how we felt when we said how or notwithstanding. Our consciousness of these transitive states is shut up to their own moment, hence one difficulty in introspective psychologizing. Any state of mind which is shut up to its own moment and fails to become an object for succeeding states of mind is as if it belonged to another stream of thought. Or rather, it belongs only physically, not intellectually, to its own stream, forming a bridge from one segment of it to another, but not being appropriated inwardly by former segments or appearing as part of the empirical self, in the manner explained in Chapter 10. All the intellectual value for us of a state of mind depends on our after-memory of it. Only then is it combined in a system and knowingly made to contribute to a result. Only then does it count for us. So that the effective consciousness we have of our states is the after-consciousness, and the more of this there is, the more influence does the original state have, and the more permanent a factor is it of our world. An indelibly imprinted pain may color a life, but, as Professor Richet says, to suffer for only a hundredth of a second is not to suffer at all. And for my part, one would readily agree to undergo a pain, however acute and intense it might be, provided it should last only a hundredth of a second, and leave after it neither reverberation nor recall. Not that a momentary state of consciousness need be practically resultless. Far from it, such a state, though absolutely unremembered, might at its own moment determine the transition of our thinking in a vital way, and decide our action irrevocably. But the idea of it could not afterwards determine transition and action, its content could not be conceived as one of the mind's permanent meanings. That is all I mean by saying that its intellectual value lies in after-memory. As a rule, sensations outlast for some little time the objective stimulus which occasioned them. This phenomenon is the ground of those afterimages which are familiar in the physiology of the sense organs. If we open our eyes instantaneously upon a scene, and then shroud them in complete darkness, it will be as if we saw the scene in ghostly light through the dark screen. We can read off details in it which were unnoticed whilst the eyes were open. In every sphere of sense, an intermittent stimulus, often enough repeated, produces a continuous sensation. This is because the afterimage of the impression just gone by blends with the new impression coming in. The effects of stimuli may thus be superposed upon each other many stages deep, the total result in consciousness being an increase in the feeling's intensity, and in all probability, as we saw in the last chapter, an elementary sense of the lapse of time, see page 635. Exner writes, "Impressions to which we are inattentive leave so brief an image in the memory that it is usually overlooked. When deeply absorbed, we do not hear the clock strike. But our attention may awake after the striking has ceased, and we may then count off the strokes. Such examples are often found in daily life. We can also prove the existence of this primary memory image, as it may be called, in another person, even when his attention is completely absorbed elsewhere. Ask someone, example, to count the lines of a printed page as fast as he can, and whilst this is going on, walk a few steps about the room. Then, when the person has done counting, ask him where you stood. He will always reply quite definitely that you have walked. Analogous experiments may be made with vision. This primary memory image is, whether attention have been turned to the impression or not, an extremely lively one, but is subjectively quite distinct from every sort of afterimage or hallucination. It vanishes, if not caught by attention, in the course of a few seconds. Even when the original impression is attended to, the liveliness of its image in memory fades fast. The physical condition in the nerve tissue of this primary memory is called by Richet, elementary memory. I much prefer to reserve the word memory for the conscious phenomenon. What happens in the nerve tissue is but an example of that plasticity or of semi-inertness, yielding to change, but not yielding instantly or wholly, and never quite recovering the original form, which, in Chapter 5, we saw to be the groundwork of habit. Elementary habit would be the better name for what Professor Richet means. Well, the first manifestation of elementary habit is the slow dying away of an impressed movement on the neural matter, and its first effect in consciousness is this so-called elementary memory. But what elementary memory makes us aware of is the just past. The objects we feel in this directly intuited past differ from properly recollected objects. An object which is recollected, in the proper sense of that term, is one which has been absent from consciousness altogether, and now revives anew. It is brought back, recalled, fished up, so to speak, from a reservoir in which, with countless other objects, it lay buried and lost from view. But an object of primary memory is not thus brought back, it never was lost, its date was never cut off in consciousness from that of the immediately present moment. In fact, it comes to us as belonging to the rearward portion of the present space of time, and not to the genuine past. In the last chapter zero, we saw that the portion of time which we directly intuit has a breadth of several seconds, a rearward and a forward end, and may be called the specious present. All stimuli whose first nerve vibrations have not yet ceased seem to be conditions of our getting this feeling of the specious present. They give rise to objects which appear to the mind as events just past. When we have been exposed to an unusual stimulus for many minutes or hours, a nervous process is set up which results in the haunting of consciousness by the impression for a long time afterwards. The tactile and muscular feelings of a day of skating or riding, after long disuse of the exercise, will come back to us all through the night. Images of the field of view of the microscope will annoy the observer for hours after an unusually long sitting at the instrument. A thread tied around the finger, an unusual constriction in the clothing, will feel as if still there, long after they have been removed. These revivals, called phenomena of Sinnesgedächtnis by the Germans, have something periodical in their nature. They show that profound rearrangements and slow settlings into a new equilibrium are going on in the neural substance, and they form the transition to that more peculiar and proper phenomenon of memory, of which the rest of this chapter zero must treat. The first condition which makes a thing susceptible of recall after it has been forgotten is that the original impression of it should have been prolonged enough to give rise to a recurrent image of it, as distinguished from one of those primary afterimages which very fleeting impressions may leave behind, and which contain in themselves no guarantee that they will ever come back after having once faded away. A certain length of stimulation seems demanded by the inertia of the nerve substance. Exposed to a shorter influence, its modification fails to set, and it retains no effective tendency to fall again into the same form of vibration at which the original feeling was due. This, as I said at the outset, may be the reason why only substantive and not transitive states of mind are as a rule recollected, at least as independent things. The transitive states pass by too quickly. Analysis of the phenomenon of memory. Memory proper, or secondary memory as it might be styled, is the knowledge of a former state of mind after it has already once dropped from consciousness, or rather it is the knowledge of an event, or fact, of which meantime we have not been thinking, with the additional consciousness that we have thought or experienced it before. The first element which such a knowledge involves would seem to be the revival in the mind of an image or copy of the original event. and it is an assumption made by many writers that the revival of an image is all that is needed to constitute the memory of the original occurrence. But such a revival is obviously not a memory, whatever else it may be, it is simply a duplicate, a second event, having absolutely no connection with the first event except that it happens to resemble it. The clock strikes today, it struck yesterday, and may strike a million times ere it wears out. The rain pours through the gutter this week, it did so last week, and will do so in saecula saeculorum. But does the present clock stroke become aware of the past ones, or the present stream recollect the past stream, because they repeat and resemble them? Assuredly not. And let it not be said that this is because clock strokes and gutters are physical and not psychical objects, for psychical objects, sensations for example, simply recurring in successive editions will remember each other on that account no more than clock strokes do. No memory is involved in the mere fact of recurrence. The successive editions of a feeling are so many independent events, each snug in its own skin. Yesterday's feeling is dead and buried, and the presence of today's is no reason why it should resuscitate. A farther condition is required before the present image can be held to stand for a past original. That condition is that the fact imaged be expressly referred to the past, thought as in the past. But how can we think a thing as in the past, except by thinking of the past together with the thing, and of the relation of the two? And how can we think of the past? In the chapter 0 on time perception we have seen that our intuitive or immediate consciousness of pastness hardly carries us more than a few seconds backward of the present instant of time. Remoter dates are conceived, not perceived, known symbolically by names, such as last week, 1850, or thought of by events which happened in them, as the year in which we attended such a school, or met with such a loss, so that if we wish to think of a particular past epoch, we must think of a name or other symbol, or else of certain concrete events, associated therewithal. Both must be thought of, to think the past epoch adequately. And to refer any special fact to the past epoch is to think that fact with the names and events which characterize its date, to think it, in short, with a lot of contiguous associates. But even this would not be memory. Memory requires more than mere dating of a fact in the past. It must be dated in my past. In other words, I must think that I directly experienced its occurrence. It must have that warmth and intimacy, which were so often spoken of in the chapter 0 on the self, as characterizing all experiences appropriated by the thinker as his own. A general feeling of the past direction in time, then, a particular date conceived as lying along that direction, and I defined by its name or phenomenal contents, an event imagined as located therein, and owned as part of my experience, such are the elements of every act of memory. It follows that what we began by calling the image, or copy, of the fact in the mind, is really not there at all in that simple shape, as a separate idea. Or at least, if it be there as a separate idea, no memory will go with it. What memory goes with is, on the contrary, a very complex representation, that of the fact to be recalled plus its associates, the whole forming one object, as explained on page 275, chapter 9, known in one integral pulse of consciousness, as set forth on pages 276 ff, and demanding probably a vastly more intricate brain process than that on which any simple sensorial image depends. Most psychologists have given a perfectly clear analysis of the phenomenon we describe. Christian Wolff, for example, writes, "Suppose you have seen Mevius in the temple, but now afresh in Titus' house. I say you recognize Mevius, that is, are conscious of having seen him before because, although now you perceive him with your senses along with Titus' house, your imagination produces an image of him along with one of the temple, and of the acts of your own mind reflecting on Mevius in the temple. Hence the idea of Mevius which is reproduced in sense is contained in another series of perceptions than that which formerly contained it, and this difference is the reason why we are conscious of having had it before. For whilst now you see Mevius in the house of Titus, your imagination places him in the temple, and renders you conscious of the state of mind which you found in yourself when you beheld him there. By this you know that you have seen him before, that is, you recognize him. But you recognize him because his idea is now contained in another series of perceptions from that in which you first saw him." Similarly, James Mill writes, "In my remembrance of George III, addressing the two Houses of Parliament, There is, first of all, the mere idea, or simple apprehension, the conception, as it is sometimes called, of the objects. There is combined with this, to make it memory, my idea of my having seen and heard those objects. And this combination is so close that it is not in my power to separate them. I cannot have the idea of George III, his person and attitude, the paper he held in his hand, the sound of his voice while reading from it, without having the other idea along with it, that of my having been a witness of the scene. If this explanation of the case in which we remember sensations is understood, the explanation of the case in which we remember ideas cannot occasion much of difficulty. I have a lively recollection of Polyphemus's cave, and the actions of Ulysses and the Cyclops, as described by Homer. In this recollection there is, first of all, the ideas, or simple conceptions of the objects and acts, and along with these ideas, and so closely combined as not to be separable, the idea of my having formerly had those same ideas. And this idea of my having formerly had those ideas is a very complicated idea, including the idea of myself of the present moment remembering, and that of myself of the past moment conceiving, and the whole series of the states of consciousness, which intervene between myself remembering, and myself conceiving. Memory is then the feeling of belief in a peculiar complex object, but all the elements of this object may be known to other states of belief, nor is there in the particular combination of them as they appear in memory anything so peculiar as to lead us to oppose the latter to other sorts of thought as something altogether sui generis, needing a special faculty to account for it. Practically, says Mr. Verdon, we sometimes keep a matter in hand not exactly by attending to it, but by keeping our attention referred to something connected with it from time to time. Translating this into the language of physiology, we mean that by referring attention to a part within, or closely connected with, the system of traces required to be remembered, we keep it well fed, so that the traces are preserved with the utmost delicacy. This is perhaps as near as we can get to an explanation. Setting the mind to remember a thing involves a continual minimal irradiation of excitement into paths which lead thereto, involves the continued presence of the thing in the fringe of our consciousness. Letting the thing go involves withdrawal of the irradiation, unconsciousness of the thing, and, after a time, obliteration of the paths. A curious peculiarity of our memory is that things are impressed better by active than by passive repetition. I mean that in learning by heart, for example, when we almost know the piece, it pays better to wait and recollect by an effort from within than to look at the book again. If we recover the words in the former way, we shall probably know them the next time. If in the latter way, we shall very likely need the hook once more. The learning by heart means the formation of paths from a former set to a later set of cerebral word processes, call 1 and 2 in the diagram the processes in question, then when we remember by inward effort, the path is formed by discharge from 1 to 2, just as it will afterwards be used. But when we excite 2 by the eye, although the path 1 to minus 2 doubtless is then shot through also, the phenomenon which we are discussing shows that the direct discharge from 1 into 2, unaided by the eyes, plows the deeper and more permanent groove. There is, moreover, a greater amount of tension accumulated in the brain before the discharge from 1 to 2, when the latter takes place unaided by the eye. This is proved by the general feeling of strain in the effort to remember 2, and this also ought to make the discharge more violent and the path more deep. A similar reason doubtless accounts for the familiar fact that we remember our own theories, our own discoveries, combinations, inventions, in short whatever ideas originate in our own brain, a thousand times better than exactly similar things which are communicated to us from without. A word, in closing, about the metaphysics involved in remembering. According to the assumptions of this book, thoughts accompany the brain's workings, and those thoughts are cognitive of realities. The whole relation is one which we can only write down empirically, confessing that no glimmer of explanation of it is yet in sight. That brains should give rise to a knowing consciousness at all, this is the one mystery which returns, no matter of what sort the consciousness and of what sort the knowledge may be. Sensations, aware of mere qualities, involve the mystery as much as thoughts, aware of complex systems, involve it. To the Platonizing tradition in philosophy, however, this is not so. Sensational consciousness is something quasi-material, hardly cognitive, which one need not much wonder at. Relating consciousness is quite the reverse, and the mystery of it is unspeakable. Professor Ladd, for example, in his usually excellent book, after well showing the matter-of-fact dependence of retention and reproduction on brain paths, says, in the study of perception, psychophysics can do much towards a scientific explanation. It can tell what qualities of stimuli produce certain qualities of sensations, it can suggest a principle relating the quantity of the stimuli to the intensity of the sensation, it can investigate the laws under which, by combined action of various excitations, the sensations are combined into presentations of sense. It can show how the time relations of the sensations and percepts in consciousness correspond to the objective relations in time of the stimulations. But for that spiritual activity which actually puts together in consciousness the sensations, it cannot even suggest the beginning of a physical explanation. Moreover, no cerebral process can be conceived of, which in case it were known to exist could possibly be regarded as a fitting basis for this unifying actus of mind. Thus also, and even more emphatically, must we insist upon the complete inability of physiology to suggest an explanation for conscious memory, in so far as it is memory, that is, in so far as it most imperatively calls for explanation. The very essence of the act of memory consists in the ability to say, this afterimage is the image of a percept I had a moment since, or this image of memory is the image of the percept I had at a certain time I do not remember precisely how long since. It would, then, be quite contrary to the facts to hold that, when an image of memory appears in consciousness, it is recognized as belonging to a particular original percept on account of its perceived resemblance to this percept. The original percept does not exist and will never be reproduced. Even more palpably false and absurd would it be to hold that any similarity of the impressions or processes in end organs or central organs explains the act of conscious memory. Consciousness knows nothing of such similarity, knows nothing even of the existence of nervous impressions and processes. Moreover, we could never know two impressions or processes that are separated in time to be similar, without involving the same inexplicable act of memory. It is a fact of consciousness on which all possibility of connected experience and of recorded and cumulative human knowledge is dependent that certain phases or products of consciousness appear with a claim to stand for, to represent, past experiences to which they are regarded as in some respect similar. It is this peculiar claim in consciousness which constitutes the essence of an act of memory, it is this which makes the memory wholly inexplicable as a mere persistence or recurrence of similar impressions. It is this which makes conscious memory a spiritual phenomenon, the explanation of which, as arising out of nervous processes and conditions, is not simply undiscovered in fact, but utterly incapable of approach by the imagination. When, then, we speak of a physical basis of memory, recognition must be made of the complete inability of science to suggest any physical process which can be conceived of as correlated with that peculiar and mysterious actus of the mind, connecting its present and its past, which constitutes the essence of memory. This passage seems to me characteristic of the reigning halfway modes of thought. It puts the difficulties in the wrong places. At one moment it seems to admit with the cruder sensationalists that the material of our thoughts is independent sensations reproduced, and that the putting together of these sensations would be knowledge, if it could only be brought about, the only mystery being as to the what actus can bring it about. At another moment it seems to contend that even this sort of combining would not be knowledge, because certain of the elements connected must claim to represent or stand for past originals, which is incompatible with their being mere images revived. The result is various confused and scattered mysteries and unsatisfied intellectual desires. But why not pool our mysteries into one great mystery, the mystery that brain processes occasion knowledge at all? It is surely no different mystery to feel myself by means of one brain process writing at this table now, and by means of a different brain process at your hands to remember myself writing. All that psychology can do is to seek to determine what the several brain processes are, and this, in a wretchedly imperfect way, is what such writings as the present chapter zero have begun to do. But of images reproduced, and claiming to represent, and put together by a unifying actus, I have been silent, because such expressions either signify nothing, or they are only roundabout ways of simply saying that the past is known when certain brain conditions are fulfilled, and it seems to me that the straightest and shortest way of saying that is the best. For a history of opinion about memory, and other bibliographic references, I must refer to the admirable little monograph on the subject by Mr. W. H. Burnham in the American Journal of Psychology, Volumes I and II. Useful books are D. K.'s Memory, What It Is, and How to Improve It, 1888, and F. Foth's Das Gedächtnis, Studies zu einer Pädagogik, etc., 1888. End of Volume 1. When later we come to our Chapter 0 on belief, we shall see that any represented object which is connected either mediately or immediately with our present sensations or emotional activities tends to be believed in as a reality. The sense of a peculiar active relation in it to ourselves is what gives to an object the characteristic quality of reality, and a merely imagined past event differs from a recollected one only in the absence of this peculiar feeling relation. The electric current, so to speak, between it and our present self does not close. But in their other determinations, the re-recollected past and the imaginary past may be much the same. In other words, there is nothing unique in the object of memory, and no special faculty is needed to account for its formation. It is a synthesis of parts thought of as related together, perception, imagination, comparison, and reasoning being analogous syntheses of parts into complex objects. The objects of any of these faculties may awaken belief or fail to awaken it. The object of memory is only an object imagined in the past, usually very completely imagined there, to which the emotion of belief adheres. Memory's causes. Such being the phenomenon of memory, or the analysis of its object, can we see how it comes to pass? Can we lay bare its causes? Its complete exercise presupposes two things: 1, the retention of the remembered fact; 2, its reminiscence, recollection, reproduction, or recall. Now the cause both of retention and of recollection is the law of habit in the nervous system, working as it does in the association of ideas. Associationists have long explained recollection by association. James Mill gives an account of it which I am unable to improve upon, unless it might be by translating his word idea into thing thought of, or object, as explained so often before. There is, he says, a state of mind familiar to all men, in which we are said to remember. In this state it is certain we have not in the mind the idea which we are trying to have in it. How is it, then, that we proceed in the course of our endeavor to procure its introduction into the mind? If we have not the idea itself, we have certain ideas connected with it. We run over those ideas, one after another, in hopes that some one of them will suggest the idea we are in quest of, and if any one of them does, it is always one so connected with it as to call it up in the way of association. I meet an old acquaintance, whose name I do not remember, and wish to recollect. I run over a number of names, in hopes that some of them may be associated with the idea of the individual. I think of all the circumstances in which I have seen him engaged, the time when I knew him, the persons along with whom I knew him, the things he did or the things he suffered, and, if I chance upon any idea with which the name is associated, then immediately I have the recollection; if not, my pursuit of it is vain. There is another set of cases, very familiar, but affording very important evidence on the subject. It frequently happens that there are matters which we desire not to forget. What is the contrivance to which we have recourse for preserving the memory, that is, for making sure that it will be called into existence when it is our wish that it should? All men invariably employ the same expedient. They endeavor to form an association between the idea of the thing to be remembered and some sensation or some idea which they know beforehand will occur at or near the time when they wish the remembrance to be in their minds. If this association is formed, and the association or idea with which it has been formed occurs, the sensation, or idea, calls up the remembrance, and the object of him who formed the association is attained. To use a vulgar instance, a man receives a commission from his friend, and, that he may not forget it, ties a knot in his handkerchief. How is this fact to be explained? First of all, the idea of the commission is associated with the making of the knot. Next, the handkerchief is a thing which it is known beforehand will be frequently seen, and of course at no great distance of time from the occasion on which the memory is desired. The handkerchief being seen, the knot is seen, and this sensation recalls the idea of the commission, between which and itself the association had been purposely formed. In short, we make search in our memory for a forgotten idea, just as we rummage our house for a lost object. In both cases we visit what seems to us the probable neighborhood of that which we miss. We turn over the things under which, or within which, or alongside of which, it may possibly be, and if it lies near them, it soon comes to view. But these matters, in the case of a mental object sought, are nothing but its associates. The machinery of recall is thus the same as the machinery of association, and the machinery of association, as we know, is nothing but the elementary law of habit in the nerve centers. And this same law of habit is the machinery of retention also. Retention means liability to recall, and it means nothing more than such liability. The only proof of there being retention is that recall actually takes place. The retention of an experience is, in short, but another name for the possibility of thinking it again, or the tendency to think it again, with its past surroundings. Whatever accidental cue may turn this tendency into an actuality, the permanent ground of the tendency itself lies in the organized neural paths by which the cue calls up the experience on the proper occasion, together with its past associates, the sense that the self was there, the belief that it really happened, etc., etc., just as previously described. When the recollection is of the ready sort, the resuscitation takes place the instant the occasion arises. When it is slow, resuscitation comes after delay. But be the recall prompt or slow, the condition which makes it possible at all, or in other words, the retention of the experience, is neither more nor less than the brain paths which associate the experience with the occasion and cue of the recall. When slumbering, these paths are the condition of retention; when active, they are the condition of recall. A simple scheme will now make the whole cause of memory plain. Let N be a past event, O its setting, concomitants, date, self-present, warmth and intimacy, etc., etc., as already set forth, and M some present thought or fact which may appropriately become the occasion of its recall. Let the nerve centers, active in the thought of M, N, and O, be represented by M, N, and O, respectively. Then the existence of the paths MN and NO will be the fact indicated by the phrase, retention of the event N in the memory, and the excitement of the brain along these paths will be the condition of the event N's actual recall. The retention of N, it will be observed, is no mysterious storing up of an idea in an unconscious state. It is not a fact of the mental order at all. It is a purely physical phenomenon, a morphological feature, the presence of these paths, namely, in the finest recesses of the brain's tissue. The recall or recollection, on the other hand, is a psychophysical phenomenon, with both a bodily and a mental side. The bodily side is the functional excitement of the tracks and paths in question, the mental side is the conscious vision of the past occurrence, and the belief that we experienced it before. These habit-worn paths of association are a clear rendering of what authors mean by predispositions, vestiges, traces, etc., left in the brain by past experience. Most writers leave the nature of these vestiges vague, few think of explicitly assimilating them to channels of association. Dr. Maudsley, for example, writes, "When an idea which we have once had is excited again, there is a reproduction of the same nervous current, with the conscious addition that it is a reproduction, it is the same idea plus the consciousness that it is the same. The question then suggests itself, what is the physical condition of this consciousness? What is the modification of the anatomical substrata of fibers and cells, or of their physiological activity, which is the occasion of this plus element in the reproduced idea? It may be supposed that the first activity did leave behind it, when it subsided, some after effect, some modification of the nerve element, whereby the nerve circuit was disposed to fall again readily into the same action. Such disposition appearing in consciousness as recognition or memory. Memory is, in fact, the conscious phase of this physiological disposition when it becomes active or discharges its functions on the recurrence of the particular mental experience. To assist our conception of what may happen, let us suppose the individual nerve elements to be endowed with their own consciousness. And let us assume them to be, as I have supposed, modified in a certain way by the first experience. It is hard to conceive that when they fall into the same action on another occasion they should not recognize or remember it. For the second action is a reproduction of the first, with the addition of what it contains from the after-effects of the first. As we have assumed the process to be conscious, this reproduction with its addition would be a memory or remembrance. In this passage, Dr. Maudsley seems to mean by the nerve element, or anatomical substratum of fibers and cells, something that corresponds to the end of our diagram. And the modification he speaks of seems intended to be understood as an internal modification of this same particular group of elements. Now, the slightest reflection will convince anyone that there is no conceivable ground for supposing that with the mere re-excitation of N there should arise the conscious addition, that it is a re-excitation. The two excitations are simply two excitations, their consciousnesses are two consciousnesses, they have nothing to do with each other. And a vague modification, supposed to be left behind by the first excitation, helps us not a whit. 4. According to all analogy, such a modification can only result in making the next excitation more smooth and rapid. This might make it less conscious, perhaps, but could not endow it with any reference to the past. The gutter is worn deeper by each successive shower, but not for that reason brought into contact with previous showers. Psychology, which Dr. Maudsley in his next sentence says, affords us not the least help in this matter, puts us on the track of an at least possible brain explanation. As it is the setting O of the idea, when it recurs, which makes us conscious of it as past, so it can be no intrinsic modification of the nerve element N which is the organic condition of memory, but something extrinsic to it altogether, namely, its connections with those other nerve elements which we called O, that letter standing in the scheme for the cerebral substratum of a great plexus of things other than the principal event remembered, dates, names, concrete surroundings, realized intervals, and whatnot. The modification is the formation in the plastic nerve substance of the system of associative paths between N and O. The only hypothesis, in short, to which the facts of inward experience give countenance is that the brain tracts excited by the event proper, and those excited in its recall, are in part different from each other. If we could revive the past event without any associates, we should exclude the possibility of memory, and simply dream that we were undergoing the experience as if for the first time. Wherever, in fact, the recalled event does appear without a definite setting, it is hard to distinguish it from a mere creation of fancy. But in proportion as its image lingers and recalls associates which gradually become more definite, it grows more and more distinctly into a remembered thing. For example, I enter a friend's room and see on the wall a painting. At first I have the strange, wondering consciousness, surely I have seen that before, but when or how does not become clear. There only clings to the picture a sort of penumbra of familiarity, when suddenly I exclaim, I have it, it is a copy of part of one of the Fra Angelicos in the Florentine Academy, I recollect it there. But the motive to the recall does not lie in the fact that the brain tract now excited by the painting was once before excited in a similar way. It lies simply and solely in the fact that with that brain tract other tracts also are excited. Those which sustain my friend's room with all its peculiarities, on the one hand. Those which sustain the mental image of the Florence Academy, on the other hand, with the circumstances of my visit there. And finally those which make me, more dimly, think of the years I have lived through between these two times. The result of this total brain disturbance is a thought with a peculiar object, namely, that I who now stand here with this picture before me, stood so many years ago in the Florentine Academy looking at its original. M. Taine has described the gradual way in which a mental image develops into an object of memory, in his usual vivid fashion. He says, I meet casually in the street a person whose appearance I am acquainted with, and say to myself at once that I have seen him before. Instantly the figure recedes into the past, and wavers about there vaguely, without at once fixing itself in any spot. It persists in me for some time, and surrounds itself with new details. When I saw him he was bareheaded, with a working jacket on, painting in a studio, he is so and so, of such and such a street. But when was it? It was not yesterday, nor this week, nor recently. I have it, he told me that he was waiting for the first leaves to come out to go into the country. It was before the spring. But at what exact date? I saw, the same day, P. people carrying branches in the streets and on the buses, it was Palm Sunday. Observe the travels of the internal figure, its various shiftings to front and rear along the line of the past. Each of these mental sentences has been a swing of the balance. When confronted with the present sensation and with the latent swarm of indistinct images which repeat our recent life, the figure first recoiled suddenly to an indeterminate distance. Then, completed by precise details, and confronted with all the shortened images by which we sum up the proceedings of a day or a week, it again receded beyond the present day, beyond yesterday, the day before, the week, still farther, beyond the ill-defined mass constituted by our recent recollections. Then something said by the painter was recalled, and it at once receded again beyond an almost precise limit, which is marked by the image of the green leaves and denoted by the word spring. A moment afterwards, thanks to a new detail, the recollection of the branches, it has shifted again, but forward this time, not backward, and, by a reference to the calendar, is situated at a precise point, a week further back than Easter, and 5 weeks nearer than the carnival, by the double effect of the contrary impulsions, pushing it, one forward and the other backward, and which are, at a particular moment, annulled by one another. The conditions of goodness in memory. The remembered fact being N, then, the path NO is what arouses for N its setting when it is recalled, and makes it other than a mere imagination. The path MN, on the other hand, gives the cue or occasion of its being recalled at all. Memory being this altogether conditioned on brain paths, its excellence in a given individual will depend partly on the number and partly on the persistence of these paths. The persistence or permanence of the paths is a physiological property of the brain tissue of the individual, whilst their number is altogether due to the facts of his mental experience. Let the quality of permanence in the paths be called the native tenacity, or physiological retentiveness. This tenacity differs enormously from infancy to old age, and from one person to another. Some minds are like wax under a seal, no impression, however disconnected with others, is wiped out. Others, like a jelly, vibrate to every touch, but under usual conditions retain no permanent mark. These latter minds, before they can recollect a fact, must weave it into their permanent stores of knowledge. They have no desultory memory. Those persons, on the contrary, who retain names, dates and addresses, anecdotes, gossip, poetry, quotations, and all sorts of miscellaneous facts, without an effort, have desultory memory in a high degree, and certainly owe it to the unusual tenacity of their brain substance for any path once formed therein. No one probably was ever effective on a voluminous scale without a high degree of this physiological retentiveness. In the practical as in the theoretic life, the man whose acquisition stick is the man who is always achieving and advancing, whilst his neighbors, spending most of their time in relearning what they once knew but have forgotten, simply hold their own. A Charlemagne, a Luther, a Leibniz, a Walter Scott, any example, in short, of your quarto or folio editions of mankind, must needs have amazing retentiveness of the purely physiological sort. Men without this retentiveness may excel in the quality of their work at this point or at that, but will never do such mighty sums of it, or be influential contemporaneously on such a scale. But there comes a time of life for all of us when we can do no more than hold our own in the way of acquisitions, when the old paths fade as fast as the new ones form in our brain, and when we forget in a week quite as much as we can learn in the same space of time. This equilibrium may last many, many years. In extreme old age it is upset in the reverse direction, and forgetting prevails over acquisition, or rather there is no acquisition. Brain paths are so transient that in the course of a few minutes of conversation the same question is asked and its answer forgotten half a dozen times. Then the superior tenacity of the paths formed in childhood becomes manifest. The dotard will retrace the facts of his earlier years after he has lost all those of later date. So much for the permanence of the paths. Now for their number. It is obvious that the more there are of such paths as MN in the brain, and the more of such possible cues or occasions for the recall of N in the mind, the prompter and surer, on the whole, the memory of N will be, the more frequently one will be reminded of it, the more avenues of approach to it one will possess. In mental terms, the more other facts a fact is associated with in the mind, the better possession of it our memory retains. Each of its associates becomes a hook to which it hangs, a means to fish it up by when sunk beneath the surface. Together, they form a network of attachments by which it is woven into the entire tissue of our thought. The secret of a good memory is thus the secret of forming diverse and multiple associations with every fact we care to retain. But this forming of associations with a fact, what is it but thinking about the fact as much as possible? Briefly, then, of two men with the same outward experiences and the same amount of mere native tenacity, the one who thinks over his experiences most, and weaves them into systematic relations with each other, will be the one with the best memory. We see examples of this on every hand. Most men have a good memory for facts connected with their own pursuits. The college athlete who remains a dunce at his books will astonish you by his knowledge of men's records in various feats and games, and will be a walking dictionary of sporting statistics. The reason is that he is constantly going over these things in his mind, and comparing and making series of them. They form for him not so many odd facts, but a concept system, so they stick. So the merchant remembers prices, the politician other politicians' speeches and votes, with a copiousness which amazes outsiders, but which the amount of thinking they bestow on these subjects easily explains. The great memory for facts which a Darwin and a Spencer reveal in their books is not incompatible with the possession on their part of a brain with only a middling degree of physiological retentiveness. Let a man early in life set himself the task of verifying such a theory as that of evolution, and facts will soon cluster and cling to him like grapes to their stem. Their relations to the theory will hold them fast, and the more of these the mind is able to discern, the greater the erudition will become. Meanwhile, the theorist may have little, if any, desultory memory. Unutilizable facts may be unnoted by him and forgotten as soon as heard. An ignorance almost as encyclopedic as his erudition may coexist with the latter, and hide, as it were, in the interstices of its web. Those who have had much to do with scholars and savants will readily think of examples of the class of mind I mean. In a system, every fact is connected with every other by some thought relation. The consequence is that every fact is retained by the combined suggestive power of all the other facts in the system, and forgetfulness is well nigh impossible. The reason why cramming is such a bad mode of study is now made clear. I mean by cramming that way of preparing for examinations by committing points to memory during a few hours or days of intense application immediately preceding the final ordeal, little or no work having been performed during the previous course of the term. Things learned thus in a few hours, on one occasion, for one purpose, cannot possibly have formed many associations with other things in the mind. Their brain processes are led into by few paths, and are relatively little liable to be awakened again. Speedy oblivion is the almost inevitable fate of all that is committed to memory in this simple way. Whereas, on the contrary, the same materials taken in gradually, day after day, recurring in different contexts, considered in various relations, associated with other external incidents, and repeatedly reflected on, grow into such a system, form such connections with the rest of the mind's fabric, lie open to so many paths of approach, that they remain permanent possessions. This is the intellectual reason why habits of continuous application should be enforced in educational establishments. Of course, there is no moral turpitude in cramming. If it led to the desired end of secure learning, it would be infinitely the best method of study. But it does not, and students themselves should understand the reason why. One's native retentiveness is unchangeable. It will now appear clear that all improvement of the memory lies in the line of elaborating the associates of each of the several things to be remembered. No amount of culture would seem capable of modifying a man's general retentiveness. This is a physiological quality, given once for all with his organization, and which he can never hope to change. It differs no doubt in disease and health, and it is a fact of observation that it is better in fresh and vigorous hours than when we are fagged or ill. We may say, then, that a man's native tenacity will fluctuate somewhat with his hygiene, and that whatever is good for his tone of health will also be good for his memory. We may even say that whatever amount of intellectual exercise is bracing to the general tone and nutrition of the brain will also be profitable to the general retentiveness. But more than this we cannot say, and this, it is obvious, is far less than most people believe. It is, in fact, commonly thought that certain exercises, systematically repeated, will strengthen not only a man's remembrance of the particular facts used in the exercises, but his faculty for remembering facts at large. And a plausible case is always made out by saying that practice in learning words by heart makes it easier to learn new words in the same way. If this be true, then what I have just said is false, and the whole doctrine of memory is due to paths must be revised. But I am disposed to think the alleged fact untrue. I have carefully questioned several mature actors on the point, and all have denied that the practice of learning parts has made any such difference as is alleged. What it has done for them is to improve their power of studying a part systematically. Their mind is now full of precedents in the way of intonation, emphasis, gesticulation. The new words awaken distinct suggestions and decisions, are caught up, in fact, into a pre-existing network, like the merchant's prices, or the athlete's store of records, and are recollected easier, although the mere native tenacity is not a whit improved, and is usually, in fact, impaired by age. It is a case of better remembering by better thinking. Similarly, when schoolboys improve by practice and ease of learning by heart, the improvement will, I am sure, be always found to reside in the mode of study of the particular piece, due to the greater interest, the greater suggestiveness, the generic similarity with other pieces, the more sustained attention, etc., etc., and not at all to any enhancement of the brute retentive power. The error I speak of pervades an otherwise useful and judicious book, How to Strengthen the Memory, by Dr. Holbrook of New York. The author fails to distinguish between the general physiological retentiveness and the retention of particular things, and talks as if both must be benefited by the same means. I am now treating, he says, a case of loss of memory in a person advanced in years, who did not know that his memory had failed most remarkably till I told him of it. He is making vigorous efforts to bring it back again, and with partial success. The method pursued is to spend 2 hours daily, one in the morning and one in the evening, in exercising this faculty. The patient is instructed to give the closest attention to all that he learns, so that it shall be impressed on his mind clearly. He is asked to recall every evening all the facts and experiences of the day, and again the next morning. Every name heard is written down and impressed on his mind clearly, and an effort made to recall it at intervals. 10 names from among public men are ordered to be committed to memory every week. A verse of poetry is to be learned, also a verse from the Bible, daily. He is asked to remember the number of the page in any book where any interesting fact is recorded. These and other methods are slowly resuscitating a failing memory. I find it very hard to believe that the memory of the poor old gentleman is a bit the better for all this torture except in respect of the particular facts thus wrought into it, the occurrences attended to and repeated on those days, the names of those politicians, those Bible verses, etc., etc. In another place Dr. Holbrook quotes the account given by the late Thurlow Weed, journalist and politician, of his method of strengthening his memory. My memory was a sieve. I could remember nothing. Dates, names, appointments, faces, everything escaped me. I said to my wife, Catherine, I shall never make a successful politician, for I cannot remember, and that is a prime necessity of politicians. My wife told me I must train my memory. So when I came home that night, I sat down alone and spent 15 minutes trying silently to recall with accuracy the principal events of the day. I could remember but little at first. Now I remember that I could not then recall what I had for breakfast. After a few days' practice, I found I could recall more. Events came back to me more minutely, more accurately, and more vividly than at first. After a fortnight or so of this, Catherine said, "Why don't you relate to me the events of the day, instead of recalling them to yourself? It would be interesting, and my interest in it would be a stimulus to you." Having great respect for my wife's opinion, I began a habit of oral confession, as it were, which was continued for almost 50 years. Every night, the last thing before retiring, I told her everything I could remember that had happened to me or about me during the day. I generally recalled the dishes I had had for breakfast, dinner, and tea, the people I had seen and what they had said, the editorials I had written for my paper, giving her a brief abstract of them. I mentioned all the letters I had sent and received, and the very language used, as nearly as possible. When I had walked or ridden, I told her everything that had come within my observation. I found I could say my lessons better and better every year, and instead of the practice growing irksome, it became a pleasure to go over again the events of the day. I am indebted to this discipline for a memory of somewhat unusual tenacity, and I recommend the practice to all who wish to store up facts, or expect to have much to do with influencing men. I do not doubt that Mr. Weed's practical command of his past experiences was much greater after 50 years of this heroic drill than it would have been without it. Expecting to give his account in the evening, he attended better to each incident of the day, named and conceived it differently, set his mind upon it, and in the evening went over it again. He did more thinking about it, and it stayed with him in consequence. But I venture to affirm pretty confidently, although I know how foolish it often is to deny a fact on the strength of a theory, that the same matter, casually attended to and not thought about, would have stuck in his memory no better at the end than at the beginning of his years of heroic self-discipline. He had acquired a better method of noting and recording his experiences, but his physiological retentiveness was probably not a bit improved. All improvement of memory consists, then, in the improvement of one's habitual methods of recording facts. In the traditional terminology, methods are divided into the mechanical, the ingenious, and the judicious. The mechanical methods consist in the intensification, prolongation, and repetition of the impression to be remembered.